All we like sheep have gone our own way and distanced ourselves from our only help. One righteous man, God's perfect plan to pay for our guilt, tear down what we've built. Seek his face, nothing would catch you at all. The world that he loved despised him, this man of sorrows. First he's betrayed, taken away, his friends turn their backs and hang by their necks. Silent he goes, as one who knows, despite any plea, the verdicts will be guilty as charged. Now beat him till no one can tell.
Good morning. You feel the intensity? You feel yourself a little charged? Why is that? I'll tell you why. Because this morning we're going to go with Jesus to the upper room. Let me ask you, especially those of you that are familiar with your Bible or those that have grown up in church, let me ask you, I want you to dig deep into your soul, and I want you to honestly answer. When I say to you, the Last Supper, Jesus in the Last Supper, what emotion does that evoke? What is the first instinctive thing that you feel when I talk about the Last Supper, Jesus in the Last Supper? Let me tell you what you ought to feel. You ought to feel an intensity. You ought to feel a tension that grips you, and I fear most of us don't. I fear that most of us think about a wafer and a little cup. I fear that most of us think about a chunk of bread and a warm, fuzzy group hug. And that is to miss the upper room discourse. I say this to you this morning. Get ready. Because when you go with Jesus to the upper room, let me tell you what you are really going into. You're going into a very intense time, a very intimately intense time. It is now less than 24 hours before Jesus will go to the torturous cross. Less than 24 hours. Let me try to make it personal. I want you to put yourself in this place, especially if you're a mom or a dad. I want you to imagine it's dinner time at your house, any day of any year of any time in your life. It's a regular, everyday dinner time. But here's the difference. You personally know, that within a few hours, there's going to be a home invasion, and you are going to be ambushed and taken away right in front of your family in a vicious way. More than that, you know that not only will you be ambushed in front of your family and taken away, you also know this, that you're being taken away and that tomorrow morning, the process will begin where you will be tortured. Tortured beyond belief. And then executed heinously before everyone that you love. Right in front of your children. This is Jesus in the upper room. Have you ever put yourself in that perspective as you now come to the Last Supper, as you now come to this upper room? Let me ask you, having now tried to just slightly give you a personal appreciation, two questions. The first one, remember, you know that you're about to be ambushed and taken away in front of your family, and that you know that you will be tortured and executed right in front of them tomorrow. And you've got a few hours. Here's my question. One, what do you say to them? We're about to walk with Jesus as he has the conversation that he has with those that follow him or claim to follow him. Second question, what mood do you have now? Do you understand the intensity? Do you understand the tension? That's where Jesus is as we come with him to the upper room. I say to you, welcome to John 13. We are going to continue in our series entitled The Walk of God, and we pick up now this morning in John chapter 13, and we will walk through verses 1 through 32. And I tell you this, while it is often referred to as the beginning of the final discourse, the farewell discourse of Jesus, that too is a misnomer. That's a mistake. Next week, we will begin with the final discourse and the farewell discourse. You see, this morning, when you look at John 13, 1 through 32, we're looking at a major transition point. We're looking at what is a major change, and we'll walk through this together and you'll see it, I pray. But I ask you this, prepare yourselves for a very intimate and perhaps challenging time with Jesus. But just know this, if you find yourself a little hot in the collar, don't miss the fact that Jesus is speaking as he knows that they're about to come and take him away. And in less than 24 hours, his flesh will be ripped like ribbons, and he will be tortured to the point where he can barely be recognized, and then he will die on the cross, drinking the wrath of God through the cup of all humanity's sin from those that will ultimately be redeemed. So if you feel a little squeamish this morning, I ask you to remember Jesus as you hear his words. And my prayer has been, as I prepared, that all of us will leave here differently than the way that we came, starting with me. And so I ask you now, Get ready. Let's walk with Jesus through this most intimate time. If the Sermon on the Mount is arguably the most comprehensive and best overall teaching and preaching of Jesus, then I say to you that John 13 through 17 is the most intimate time that you and I will have in Scripture with Jesus. As he now goes and transitions from the public ministry to the private ministry, I want you to see what you'll notice. What I've entitled our message today is that it's only the holy. Only the holy will go and be with Jesus into eternity. This is the essence of his message. I ask you this morning, again, what do you think of when you hear or go in your mind's eye to the Last Supper? I'm going to walk with you this morning through an acronym that I suspect will challenge many of you. And I pray that before we leave, you'll say, wow, I didn't realize that's what God was saying. The acronym that we will use to walk through John 13, verses 1 through 32 is treason. That you will see that Jesus is going to glorify himself and God the Father by addressing treason in a way that most probably do not associate with the Last Supper. Now, I will tell you this, and again, most aren't aware, but John does not look through the same perspective as the other Gospels. There's no account in John of the wine and the bread. That's not because it didn't happen, and it's not because it's not important. It's because God had John bring to you and me a different perspective. He's driving home a complementary point. And that's what I pray we will see this morning. As we walk through this passage, the treason stands for, the T in treason will be a transition of truth. You'll see in verse 1. You'll see in verse 2 that the hypocrite and the satanic is revealed. And this begins the actual discourse that begins in the upper room. You'll see the E is that those that are satanic are excluded. In the A, you'll see that they're alienated and not taken in. In the S, you'll see Christ himself speak out against the traitor. You'll see in the O that the traitors are overtaken as Satan himself indwells those children of the devil. And you'll see in the N that closes out treason, no more. There comes a point where Jesus the Christ says, no more night crawlers are accepted. So with that said, I ask you to not miss what I call the big idea, the eternal truth of this passage. And that is that you and I are to see the season and the reason for the treason. Walk away having seen the season and reason of the treason that is involved. Now, with that understanding, as we have done throughout this series, I want to show you the Word of God. But I waited till I could lay this out for you, because now I pray that you will watch as God's Word is revealed through media and see, perhaps for the first time, a different perspective on John's gospel account of the upper room beginning, the Last Supper, if you will. Watch this, and then we'll pick up.
It was now the day before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. He had always loved those in the world who were his own, and he loved them to the very end. Jesus and his disciples were at supper. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, the thought of betraying Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him complete power. He knew that he had come from God and was going to God. So he rose from the table, took off his outer garment, and tied a towel round his waist. Then he poured some water into a wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter.
Are you going to wash my feet, Lord?
You do not understand now what I am doing, but you will understand later.
Never at any time will you wash my feet.
If I do not wash your feet, you will no longer be my disciple.
Lord, do not wash only my feet, then. Wash my hands and head too.
Those who have taken a bath are completely clean and do not need to wash themselves, except for their feet. All of you are clean. All except one.
Jesus already knew who was going to betray him. That is why he said, "All of you except one are clean." After Jesus had washed their feet, he put his outer garment back on and returned to his place at the table.
Do you understand what I have just done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and it is right that you should do so because that is what I am. I, your Lord and teacher, have just washed your feet. You then should wash one another's feet. I have set an example for you, so that you will do just what I have done for you. I am telling you the truth. No slaves are greater than their master, and no messengers are greater than the one who sent them. Now that you know this truth, how happy you will be if you put it into practice. I'm not talking about all of you. I know those I have chosen. But the scripture must come true that says the man who shared my food turned against me. I tell you this now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. I am telling you the truth. Whoever receives anyone I send receives me also. And whoever receives me receives him who sent me.
After Jesus had said this, he was deeply troubled and declared openly,
I am telling you the truth. One of you is going to betray me.
The disciples looked at one another, completely puzzled about whom he meant. One of the disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was sitting next to Jesus. Simon Peter motioned to him.
Ask him whom he is talking about.
So that disciple moved closer to Jesus' side.
Who is it, Lord?
I will dip some bread in the sauce and give it to him. He is the man.
So he took a piece of bread, dipped it, and gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him.
Hurry, and do what you must.
None of the others at the table understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas was in charge of the money bag, some of the disciples thought that Jesus had told him to go and buy what they needed for the festival, or to give something to the poor. Judas accepted the bread and went out at once. It was night. After Judas had left, Jesus said,
"Now the Son of Man's glory is revealed. Now God's glory is revealed through him. And if God's glory is revealed through him, then God will reveal the glory of the Son of Man in himself. And he will do so at once."
So, let me ask you, are you familiar with that passage? I dare say most in the church would acknowledge yes, conceptually, but probably not thoroughly. Let me give you three contextual pieces that are not obvious, but are important. Most of the time, as we've walked through this series, I have intentionally not gone into the other Gospels, because I want us to have God's perspective as given through John. But to understand this passage, I think there are three pieces that you need to know and keep in mind, because it will help you to better understand this context. Number one, just before this, per Luke's gospel, Jesus made another visit to the temple where he cleaned house again, where he went back in and drove people out and said, "My Father's house is to be a house of prayer." And you see him purging there again. He started his public ministry and he ended his public ministry going to the temple, going to the church, and clearing out the hypocrites. Number two, you need to know that in this context, again, Luke tells us that just before Jesus started to clean the disciples' feet, wash their feet, the disciples were arguing over who was going to be greatest amongst them. It helps us to better understand the humility in the teaching of Jesus. And thirdly, you need to know this. Again, the other Gospels tell us that when Jesus made it clear that one would betray him, not only were the disciples asking and confused, who could it be? Judas himself looked Jesus in the eye and said, "Could it be me? No, not me, Lord." And I tell you that because I want you to understand just how brazen hypocrisy can be when it is born out of hell. Now, with that said, let's walk through this acronym of treason. And I tell you this, I use this acronym because six different times the betrayal of Judas, the traitor and his treason, is highlighted, not by me, but by God and his word. Repetition means emphasis. God is telling us this is the focus to bring glory to God. Let's walk through. We've now heard and seen the word of God, so I won't walk through it all, but I do want to walk through key aspects so that we can see this together. First, in verse 1, the T of treason is for this transition. I want you to recognize that John 13:1 is like biblical sorbet. God has given this to us, not as content for the upper room discourse, but to prepare us. We're leaving the first half of John, the public ministry where Jesus was pouring out. And now we're coming into the private ministry of Jesus, where he's going to begin to pour in to the few, to the special, chosen, set apart, true disciples of God. He says, now, before the feast of the Passover, note the time. He's making a time stamp. Now, transition point. When Jesus knew, note this, because Jesus is never going to be surprised through this whole account. He was never taken off guard. He was never a victim. He was always victorious. And even the cross is his crowning glory. You will see before we're done. He said Jesus knew that his hour had come. Here we see the fulfillment all the way through John. He kept telling, nope, my hour has not yet come. Nope, my hour has not yet come. He says here, now. Now my hour has come. He knows that within 24 hours, he will be hung on that cross. He says, the time has come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own. He says, I'm going home. Having loved his own, the elect who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Friends, John 3:16 tells us that God so loved the world. He loves everybody, but he loves the elect special. He loves his children that will be with him eternally differently than he loves all of humanity. I ask you, do you love the children in your neighborhood? I pray you say yes. Do you love the children of our community that will come to VBX? I pray you say yes. Are you honest enough to say you love your children in a different, special way? Yes. God loves his own. And he loves them, Scripture says, to the end. Some of your passages or your translations will say he loved them with the utmost or something to that effect. Listen, the word end here means completeness, perfection. He's not saying he loved them for a long time. He's saying he loved them to the point of glorifying them eternally as his own. He loved them and captured them by grace. He loved them and redeemed his own. Not everybody, his own. Friends, do you know this love? If you don't, I ask you to cry out to Jesus. This is all about him bringing glory to himself and to God the Father by dying so that you will know this love. Romans 8, 35 through 39, God's word says, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Just as it is written, for your sake we are being put to death all day long. We were considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the love. The transition now is going from telling the world his truth to now pouring into his people and saying, I have you. If you're mine, don't you ever worry. I've got you to the end. I've got you to the end. The R in our treason, we see this now in verses 2 through 9. This is where Satan is exposed. The R stands for revealed. Listen to verse 2. When the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, the devil put it into the heart of Judas to betray him. See this. Verse 1 transitions and gets us ready. The very first focal point in the upper room is Judas having now set to betray him. This is the context of the upper room. The first thing in the upper room is Jesus is addressing Judas's betrayal. Listen to Kent Hughes, an accomplished commentator. He says this to help us understand what's going on here with Judas. Judas was as perfect an actor, as accomplished a hypocrite as one can find. Theologians surmise that he was a man of more education and higher social standing than the rest of the apostles. He was not from Galilee as they were, but rather was from Judea, a much better address. H.A. Ironside said, quote, Judas was the real gentleman of all the teachers, end quote. Continuing with Hughes, he had class compared to the rest. Today, Judas would wear all the right clothes as well as wear a Madison Avenue smile. He would know all the right hymns, know when to sit down, when to stand up, when to inject the most persuasive cliche. He would know how to ingratiate himself with the power leaders of the church. No one would ever suspect him of being a traitor. So it was with Judas and the disciples in Jesus' day. Now I tell you this because very, very real to our time, is the same account. I thank God for two people in particular in the Bible outside of Christ. One is Paul, because Paul is given to us per God's word to remind us that nobody can be too bad for God's grace. That nobody is beyond salvation if they will surrender, repent, and believe, and receive Jesus Christ as Lord. I thank God for Paul. I also thank God for Judas, because Judas is given to us to remind us that there isn't anybody that can be too good to be captured by and used by the devil. He keeps us ever vigilant, reminds us that Satan is at work in the church, and it keeps we under shepherds on guard. And I pray he informs the sheep to beware the wolves. That all you have to do is look at the account of Judas. And friends, if you're a sheep, watch out. Judas is a gift given to us for God's glory. I pray that you and I will see this. In John 6:70, I want to point out to you just how pervasive the problem is. Some of you will remember when we were in chapter 6, Jesus teaches, and it says that his teaching was hard for many and that his disciples followed him no more. John 6:60. Read that. But catch this, in John 6:70, after those phonies left, Jesus said, I chose the 12 of you and one of you is a devil. In John 6, Jesus identified Judas at that time as a devil. I tell you this, friends, there are devils in the church. You say, how can you say that? I didn't. Jesus did. Jesus said this. Judas was a diabolos, a devil. Back in John 6, he now is affirming it again in John 13. Friends, disciples will fade away. Devils will follow. I want you to think about that, because I'll tell you what it does. It raises the stakes of your discernment. This is exactly why Jesus said in Matthew 10:16, I'm sending you out as sheep amongst wolves, therefore be as shrewd as a serpent and as innocent or as gentle as a dove. This is the both and. In Acts 5:3, some of you know that Ananias and Sapphira, as the birth of the church is coming, the same term of the devil persuading or the devil putting something into the heart of Judas is used with Ananias. Ananias shows up and he says, hey, we've offered to the Lord to be this incredible giver. We're going to give him everything we have. We've sold our home. And he did it for how it would look, because he was a snake and his heart was not right. And Jesus, God himself, shows up spiritually and gives Peter the insight. And the word says that Ananias was confronted and God dropped him like a bad habit. He made a point of destroying him right there on the spot because Ananias had lied about doing something that was supposedly in the name of God and for the glory of God. Same word here. Same thing happening in the heart. Here's a quote from me. In a discourse that is literally to serve as an illustrative example on the call, commission, and command to live exemplifying Christ's likeness, especially in the church, in ecclesia, in koinonia, don't miss the fact that Jesus starts with the purging and purifying of his people. This is the context of the upper room. In verse 3, we see that Jesus is sovereign. He knows all that's going to take place. There isn't anything here that's out of whack. I think of the Great Commission, Matthew 28. Jesus says, all authority on heaven and earth have been given to me. Therefore, go make disciples. This too is under God's sovereign power. Jesus is not a victim here. He's not taken off guard. The key is to look and to see what God is showing us. What is Jesus demonstrating? D.A. Carson says, and I quote, with such power and status at his disposal, we might have expected him to defeat the devil in an intimate, immediate, and flashy confrontation, and to devastate Judas with an unstoppable blast of divine wrath. Instead, he washes his disciples' feet, including the feet of the betrayer. Don't miss this, friends. Because as verse 4 through 7 show us, Jesus then gets up. He's made it clear, I know that I'm about to be betrayed. Nothing is going to take me off guard. I also hear you bickering over who's the greatest. Let me give you an example. And Jesus served the disciples. He literally got up and washed their feet. Now, that's appalling. Why? Not because of what he did, but because of who he is. Yes, there's an example that we're to serve the least of these, that we're to humble ourselves, but that's not the point. The point is that the king served like the slave. You see, foot washing in their day was only for the slaves, and in fact, it wasn't even for a Hebrew slave. The Hebrew slaves were thought to be too good. So when Jesus takes that posture, it's not what he's doing, it's who he is doing it. I want you to think of it this way. If President Obama was to show up at your house this afternoon, right? President Obama shows up at your house. What would you think after you got over the fact that he's here? The entourage is outside. You sit down and you're like, wow. And he says, you know what? Hang on a second. And he goes down into your basement. And he finds some of your overalls, some of your old dirty stuff. And he says, where's a shovel? I understand that you're having some plumbing problems out back. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and get into your sewerage. I'll take care of it. Now, I dare say that you'd be absolutely flabbergasted. And it's not because human beings are beyond sewerage problems, but you would think the President of the United States showed up and he's going to take care of my sewerage? No, can't be. Now let me ask you this, if that sounds amazing to you, how much more to think of the King of Kings taking the servant's role as they're bickering over who's the greatest of them? And I ask you, do we ever find ourselves in this place where we think we're too good for the King's service? Is there anything or any place or any people that you feel that you're above? And before you say no with your lips, I ask you to look at your life. See, it's very easy to cocoon. It's very easy to do things in the church. How humble are we? In verse 8, as Peter is saying, oh no, you can't do this for me, Jesus says, and he points out the issue of salvation. He says, no, Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him and said, unless I wash your feet, you have no part in me. Jesus is now making it clear, this is not about the menial task of washing your feet. I'm demonstrating for you that I save your soul and only I can do it. If I don't wash you, you are lost. You have no part in me. This is an example of the need and utter dependence upon Christ's own and only atonement for yours and my sins. If he doesn't wash you, if you don't surrender to him, it doesn't matter what your resume looks like. This is what he's telling Peter. And he's drawing the distinction next between salvation and sanctification. You see, Peter says, okay, then, hey, I tell you what, if I need that, then wash all of me, my hands, my feet, my everything. You know, if 2 aspirin are good, then Lord, give me 20 aspirin. And Jesus so lovingly and so graciously points out, no. You see, once you've been saved, you're saved. Once I've washed you, you no longer need to be washed anew. You need to have your feet washed daily. That's the sanctification. He says, once you're saved, but you must be sanctified every day. This is the repentance. This is the coming and asking for forgiveness. It's the difference between union and communion. You see, once you're saved, you're in union with Christ and nobody can divide you. But your communion with Christ is based on your relationship with him. And you and I can quench the spirit. You and I can hurt our relationship to the point where we may be saved, but we're still separated from the health and the joy and the peace that comes through a healthy relationship with him. God through John is showing us the difference between the clean and the unclean. On a deeper theological level, he's showing us the difference between the visible church and the invisible church. You see, throughout this acronym, each of the points of this letter is a place where Jesus is drawing the distinction between Judas and the rest, between truth and lie, between darkness and light. Here, if you read it carefully, you'll see that there's a subtle comparison that's being made between Judas and Peter, even. And Peter is far from perfect, but he's passionate. And his passions are from the heart and for God. He stumbles, we all do. The difference is that the passion of Peter's heart is grounded in Christ, and the superficiality of Judas is all caught up in self. Anyway, as we get to verses 12 through 17, listen to what God's word says. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to this place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set for you an example. And he goes on, I pray that you see the example. It's not the simple menial duty of servitude. He's saying that, listen, first and foremost, you bring glory to me, and you start off by identifying where the treason and the traitor is. And in the context of this glorifying of me, you love and serve one another. But he's again drawing the contrasts. As he has done throughout the entire Gospel of John, he continues to contrast the light and the dark, the real and the fake, the dead and the living. Ironside says here, he speaks to this issue of how you and I would wash each other's feet. And I'll just paraphrase him. He goes on and he says, well, let me quote him. How do we wash one another's feet? What was the water? The water was the word of God. Of what do our feet speak? Our feet speak of our ways. We wash one another's feet when we apply the word of God to our ways. When a Christian slips a bit, you say, perhaps, he was a wonderfully fine out-and-out Christian, but now he's getting a bit worldly. But what are you going to do about it? Well, you can just ignore it and pass it by, or you can criticize and say very unkind things, but neither of these methods will help very much. You can go to the dear brother or sister and tenderly point out from the Word of God the mistake they are making, the sin into which they are falling. You can show them how their lives are becoming defiled. That's how you wash their feet with the Word of God. Listen to Luke 11:28, again speaking to the example and the call to be. Blessed are those who hear the Word of God and obey it. 1 John 2:6, the one who says he abides in Christ, John wrote in his first epistle, they must obey himself to walk in the same way that Jesus walked. Friends, don't miss the contrast. The A in our treason, here again you see Judas is going to be alienated. Jesus says in verse 18 through 20, he says, listen, I'm not talking to all of you. What I just said does not apply to all of you. He's drawing the distinction. He contrasts the cancerous presence of Judas with those who would become his church. See, if you know you are saved and set apart, then those who reject those defining foundational truths that you bring in the power and in the truth and in the love of God's word, they show themselves in their rejection of these foundational truths to not be of Christ's kingdom. This is part of what's happening, is it's becoming clear that Judas is not in the family, and Jesus is not going to let it go. In the S of treason in verses 21 through 26, watch now as Jesus speaks out. For many of you, there's a concern. Well, you know, I don't know if you're not supposed to say anything. You know, well, that'll take care of itself, or that's a little uncomfortable. I want you to know that where treason and traitors reside, God's people speak out. And we speak out for the glory of God. It says here that after he had said this, Jesus was troubled in his spirit and testified. That term, troubled in his spirit, it was the same word that Jesus had referenced when he was standing before Lazarus' tomb. It's also in chapter 12 what Jesus referenced when he was thinking ahead to the cross. It's also the word that was used as the disciples watched Jesus walk on the water. It's to be stressed. It's to have an emotional surge that is very weighty on your heart. Why was Jesus stressed? Again, he wasn't going to be surprised. He's known all along. This is because he knew there was a snake that was in amongst the family. But here's where things get incredibly beautiful. Jesus was stressed because he loved Judas. He's stressed because he knows that this man is rejecting him and is about to go into his eternal peril. He's stressed because he cares. There is love all the way to the end when it comes to Christ and Christ-likeness. Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples stared at one another, and at a loss to know which of them they meant. Jesus later said, "It is one to whom I will give this piece of bread." In their culture, that was an honor. What Jesus did all the way to the end in identifying Judas, in speaking out, he continued to offer him the invitation for repentance. He continued to offer him a choice and a chance at redemption. But what we see is the continued rejection. So what does Jesus do? He turns the lights on. Jesus spoke out and made it clear. We see in verses 27 through 29 that now Judas is overtaken by Satan. Literally, as he takes the morsel of bread, Satan then entered him. Kent Hughes says that at that moment, an immortal soul committed suicide. Friends, I plead with you, if you are saying no to God and are hiding behind the facade of hypocrisy, if you think that your religion has got you covered and maybe none of us can see it, God sees. He knows the heart. And there will come a time, friend, if you are saying no to God, that he will say no to you. And Romans 1 makes it clear that you will be given over to the true desires of your heart and there will be no turning back. Don't play games with the God of the universe, with the Christ who would go to the cross that you could say yes. Jesus sent him away. He said, "Go away quickly. Once done, done." And please recognize, Jesus loved Judas all the way up to the end. But there came a point where he said, "Okay, go." When there is an utter rejection and total denial, there is a time that it is no longer okay. Now in verses 28 and 29, you see the disciples, they're all confused. They're all supposing, what's going on? And I just want to ask you, because see, Jesus made it very clear. He said, "The one to whom I give the bread." Now many commentators assume that he must have whispered that and that's why nobody got it. I don't believe that. Number one, there's no scriptural reason to believe it. It's inferred. But I watched Jesus speak here in the scriptures. And the scriptures say that when he told Judas to leave, that everybody was befuddled by that. Well, if they could hear that, I have no reason to believe they didn't hear the other stuff. I accredit it to their lack of focus and the goodness and the degree to which Judas had betrayed Jesus and had become so good at being bad that nobody knew. They're all confused. Now I ask you, what has God said that you should see clearly? He's made it very clear, put it right in front of you. I gave him the bread, you should know he's the one. What has God said to you personally that you know but are ignoring or defying? What does his word say clearly that you know but are ignoring and or defying? We're all at risk of this, friends. And I just pray that you don't have a Judas in either person or in some other particular that the devil is using to deceive or blind you. And the only way that you'll know is if you do as 2 Corinthians 13:5 encourages, and that is to test yourself. To see, do you not know whether or not you are in the faith? Look at the fruit of your life. Ask yourself, have I been captured by grace? Has this miracle happened, or am I a Judas? Am I in the crowd but not yet in Christ? Am I so highly thought of that everybody assumes I could be trusted? I'm a treasurer. And be an instrument of the devil. 1 John says that there will be antichrists in the church. that there will be children of the devil who are deceiving you. Judas was himself a child of the devil who ultimately is indwelt by the devil in the presence of Jesus. If that does not stir you to the point of a wake-up call, I don't know what will. And all I can do is tell you this is what Jesus said. And he loved to the end. All of this is on his way to the cross. Finally, the N of my treason acronym is Jesus closes out the passage, verses 30 through 32. This is when you see the saints versus the ain'ts. God's word says, as soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out into the night. Night was not only the time, it's the spiritual metaphor. Night and darkness is the opposite of Jesus all the way through the scriptures. God is clearly sending us a point that night had come to take over the soul of Judas. He was gone. I ask you, friends, do not drift off into the night. Do not be taken by the lures of this world, or do not try to hide behind the facades of religion. Do not do as Judas had done. John MacArthur says, at that moment, the day of salvation ended for Judas and hell arrived. Don't go there, friends. Verse 31, therefore, when he had gone out, listen, the NIV commentator says, the setting of the upper room was a spiritual turning point in which Jesus was doing profound spiritual work. But at the same time, where God is most deeply at work, Satan's attack is that much more acute. It is significant that in Luke's version of the Lord's Supper, at this point, Jesus tells Simon Peter that Satan also wanted to stir him. This is stunning. Satan's desire to sabotage the followers of Christ reached more levels than we will ever realize. Are those most intimately connected with Christ's life and work today similarly vulnerable? Judas is a parable and a warning. We read his story as insiders, thinking it depicts someone else. But Judas is a more disturbing figure than Pilate or Caiaphas, or any of the other Jewish leaders, because Judas saw the light and understood it, but he chose the darkness anyway. Friends, there are devils in the church. And the disciples of Jesus the Christ are to bring him glory by recognizing all of this was to inform and inspire you and me to Christ-likeness. He said, I set you an example. What is the example? It's to recognize that all of this is for God's glory. Listen to what he says. Now in verse 30 and 31 and 32, Jesus said, now. Judas just left and went out into the night. Jesus said, now, another time stamp. Now the Son of Man is glorified. When? After Judas left, as Jesus purged and purified his people, he says, now, at this point, the glory of God begins. He goes on and he says, the glory, now the Son of Man is glorified and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. Glory, glorified, glory, glorified, glorify. Christ has purged and purified his people. Now Christ's likeness begins in the church. Friends, don't miss this. It's the crescendo. This treason is addressed. Christ turned the lights on the traitor for God's glory. Christ served the people for God's glory. Christ is going to the cross for God's glory. Christ saves sinners for God's glory. What do you and I do, Christian? We live in Christ's likeness, and everything we do is to be Christ-like for God's glory. So each and every one of us, You are to expose darkness for God's glory. You are to serve selflessly for God's glory. You're to cut out cancers for God's glory. You're to love them until they leave for hell for God's glory. This is the example. And I tell you that as we pick up next week in verse 33, you will see the final discourse begin. All of this was to transition us out of the public pouring out into the private pouring in of those that would be his people in his church. And he starts by purifying and purging the traitor and the treason. Friends, I pray that you know that the God of the Bible, the Jesus who hung on the cross, has done all of this to bring himself glory. That this is not something that's downplayed. It's not about the downtrodden. This is about the victory and the victorious Christ. You see, the cross of Christ and the traitor and the treason, why is this here? Do you see the season and reason for the treason? It's all for God's glory. He's using even this to show that nothing has taken him off guard. Not a single dust mite is out of space. And know this, that you and I can have the confidence that our Christ is king. The crucified Christ is king. Judas and the devil think that they're doing what is going to thwart the plan of God, and instead they're the exclamation mark of his glory. Friends, the reason for treason in God's sovereign plan is to bring him glory. And this is how and why you and I can shine bright. This is why it's important to be an ambassador that does not back down. This is why you turn the lights on for your king wherever you go. And this is why you love not only the least of these, but especially the lost, who perhaps may be on the very doorstep of hell. And you love them until they leave for hell, bar none. I pray that as we embrace this truth and see what Jesus is saying, that he is lifted up, not only in our eyes, but in our hearts. And we come to know the confidence that we can have. I want to leave you with a song. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to encourage you to come and pray. Perhaps you want to purge today. Perhaps you want to be purified today. Maybe this is the day that the Lord has said to you, come clean. Surrender to victory. Stop being a Judas and come to Jesus. Maybe this is your day. Know this, that if you do, you've got a king who loved you enough to go to the cross, and who is strong enough to be the rock of your salvation and the defender of your soul from here on out. There's a song that we'll play that's called Defender. And it's upbeat and it's encouraging. And I pray you will be upbeat and encouraged by this truth. And it'll be followed by the same song that played to open up this sermon. One Righteous Man. To remind you of who you are in Christ, or perhaps today, before Christ, that you might come. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for the truth of your word. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you love us enough to show us the way, that you, our King, would die for us. And at the same time, in your victory, in your humility, you would inspire us to live as living lights, as your ambassadors. Let us, Lord, live with the lights on and to love the lost until they leave for hell. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you'd like to pray, Pastor Mike and I will be available. Your promise, the next song is your invitation. You leave at your dismissal, you know, when you feel it's time. Don't rush out. Don't feel like you have to stay. Next song is that same one, but a little longer from the beginning of the sermon to invite you into the truth of the gospel personally.
Man of sorrows. something.